Hi all, I welcome you all to the next lecture today. Here Professor Ravi Kumar, School of Mechanical Engineering, Shastra DM2B University, Tanjore. So today basically we are going to see the detailed construction of the wing design. What all the different subcomponents of a wing. In previous lecture already we have covered the general construction of fuselage, where we have seen the various subcomponents of a fuselage and fuselage manufacturing and their working principle. Today we will see the detailed view of an aircraft wing. What are the different subcomponents within the aircraft wing and what are their functions, and how actually aircraft wing used to be manufactured. That basically we are going to discuss today. So here I start my presentation. So if we look at the various wing design shapes, the first picture which is representing here is representing the tapered leading edge. If you look at the leading edge, which is tapered basically, it's not a straight, and straight trailing edge. This is the one form of wing design. Similarly, if we look at this wing design which has been shown here, here both the cases, right, even trailing edge and leading edge, both are tapered. So this design is known as tapered leading and trailing edges. If we go for high maneuverability aircraft, right, or a high performance aircrafts, right, where we will find the delta wing, so which is here, right, if you look at this delta wing. Here there is no visible horizontal stabilizer, right, so horizontal stabilizer has been removed, right, and the delta wing is basically put up to the tail portion. But you might be observing one horizontal stabilizer kind of structure, right, at the leading edge. This is not basically horizontal stabilizer. This is called canard configuration. Why do we use the canard? Canard is basically used to increase the stalling characteristics of the aircraft particularly. Next case, this if you look at in your Indian aircraft, if fighter aircraft, if you look at the Sukhoi Su-35 or most of the fighter aircraft, Jaguar, Mirage, you will find this kind of wing which is swept back, right. So if you look at the leading edge or look at the trailing edge, both will be swept back configuration. This is another form of wing design. And why do we use this kind of wing design? The interference drag will be less, and it is having high maneuverability, so it makes your aircraft more maneuverable, right? So aerobatic activities can be increased, right, and with the lower drag. This is the simplest form of aircraft wing. Basically for general aviation aircraft or sports aircraft, you may find this kind of wing design is a straight leading and trailing edge, or you can say this is a rectangular wing design, right. This is a very simplest particularly with regard to the construction, right. So construction is very simple in this case. If you look at this design, where straight leading edge but trailing edge is tapered, right, and most of the transport, some of the early as well as now in modern transport aircraft, you may find this kind of a wing configuration. So this is also very much famous, particularly in a transport aircraft. So a wing attachment point, if you look at how actually we do attach the wing with the aircraft, already I said aircraft in aircraft classifications that wings may arrange either at the bottom of fuselage or mid of the fuselage or at the top of the fuselage. So based on that we say that it is a low wing aircraft, mid wing aircraft or high wing aircraft. Particularly if we look at the transport configuration aircraft, in that you will find the high wing configuration particularly. So if you look at the high wing configuration, which will be looking like this. This is high wing configuration, right, this is a low wing configuration, and this is called mid wing configuration. Most of the aircraft particularly that we are looking at, either passenger aircraft or or fighter aircraft, they are having this kind of, you know, configuration that is called mid-wing configuration. All right. And this is a high wing configuration, and high wing configuration, basically aircraft wing will be situated at the top of the fuselage. It basically is a more stabilized design, right? So particularly in transport aircraft, we do not require too much aerobatic activities, right, or aerobatics maneuvers. In that case, we can look for highly laterally stable aircraft. For that case, high wing configuration is good compared to others. This is the low wing configuration. Low wing configuration main problem is basically the spacing from the ground. For that, we need to use these relatively larger landing gears, right, compared to other designs. So larger landing gear, this is one of the big problem. Another, if we are using propeller configuration, then also there is a problem that landing gear length should be bigger, right? That's another thing. So apart from these, right, one more famous, you know, wing attachment is called dihedral, in which wings are attached in such a way that they are making certain positive angle with the aircraft horizontal earth axis, right? So this is the angle. This angle may vary between 10 to 30 degree, right, depending on the types of aircraft. What are the advantage of dihedral? Basically, if you look at the dihedral configuration, in that case, clearance from the ground will be good, and also it is more stable, configuration compared to the low wing design. Another, opposite to that is also used, right? It is called anhedral. Anhedral, in that, it will be negative angle, and wings will be placed at the top of the fuselage. And transport aircraft, particularly, you may find, like, if you look at the IL-76 air-to-air refueling aircraft, you will find the wing configuration that is called anhedral. That is more stable with regard to the lateral stability. Apart from that, these are the two unusual wing designs. If you look at this gull shape, right, basically this gull design was taken from the eagle wing, right? If you look at the eagle, when eagle flies, right, we look at the way in which it spreads the wings, right, which will be something like this, so gull shape. And another is inverted gull, right? Same wing will be attached in this way. That is called inverted gull. So advantage of this wing configuration is, basically in early days we used this kind of wing on the transport aircraft particularly. They are more stable, right? Because here you look at in the low wing configuration or high wing configuration, at the wing and fuselage attachment, chances of interference drag is high. Interference drag will be more. That's why we required the winglets, right, particularly to avoid a cross flow of air towards the fuselage. But in this case, if you look at either this configuration or this configuration, wing attachment is almost 90 degree to the fuselage. So interference drag is less. One advantage of that, interference drag is there less. But what are the biggest disadvantages? Disadvantage is the length, means design of the wing is very, very complex. So manufacturing cost is slightly higher. And another thing is that aspect ratio is slightly bigger compared to the other wing configuration. So overall performance, if you look at, will be poor compared to the low or mid wing configuration. So the famous example is the Junkers Ju-87 Stuka. This is the transport aircraft used in early 1945, right, in the World War One time. This was much famous, wing design. But in current modern aircraft, we are not using this kind of wing design, especially gull wing or inverted gull wing. Advantage of gull wing is only it is having low interference drag, but main drawback is manufacturing cost is high compared to other wing configuration. And also these are maintenance incentives, so they need more maintenance compared to the other kind of wing configuration. These are more intensive to the manufacturing cost, and then maintenance cost is also very high. That's why these are the two biggest reason which basically ruled out the usage of gull wing to the modern aircraft. So if we look at the full cantilever wing, particularly cantilever, we used to say which cantilever beam is known as beam, which is fixed at one end and free at another end. So if you look at this, this wing is basically a cantilever wing, that we say fully cantilever wing, and wing may be attached at the top of the fuselage or at the bottom of the fuselage. This configuration is full cantilever wing in most of the aircrafts, right? Most of the passenger aircraft, you find this kind of configuration, right? That is called full cantilever wing. There is another variant that is called a semi cantilever wing. Particularly, this kind of wing configuration you will find in your general aviation aircrafts or trainer aircrafts, where your private pilot license, recruitee used to fly that one, or your sports aircraft, you find this kind of configuration. So, either it may be placed at top or bottom, but it will be supported by diagonal struts, right? This kind of struts will be there, which will be supporting your wing, right, attachment. There is another configuration, right, in the same, cantilever wing. That is, one is called wire-braced biplane, where we are using two wings, basically pair of wings, which are connected together by wire. These are the diagonal wires, right, and struts. This is called wire-braced biplane configuration in early days, right, or sports aircraft. Some of the sports aircraft in nowadays also utilizing the biplane configuration. Problem with the biplane configuration is that interference drag is more. So overall, limitation is we cannot fly the biplane configuration at high speed and at high altitude. That's the biggest disadvantage with this kind of configuration. But for low altitude and low speed, these are much more economical compared to the other configurations, right, sir? So if you look at this, this is also semi cantilever wing with a braced kind of configuration. There is a diagonal struts as well as there is a vertical members. If you look at, these are called jury struts. So apart from diagonal struts, there will be another supporting members. That is called jury struts in the case of braced configuration, braced wing configuration. This kind of design basically you will find in the lightweight aircraft or you can say the general aviation aircraft. You find this kind of configuration is much more famous. So if we look at the detailed view of a wing, if we remove the skin, if you are looking inside, you will find this kind of construction, right? So if you look at this shape particularly, which is providing the circular leading edge, and it is extending from leading edge to trailing edge along the chord length, this basically is known as rib. Rib basically, function of rib is to provide the desired shape to the wing, or you can say it is provide the aerodynamic shape or airfoil shape to the wing. So this is the nose rib, and this the rib which is extending from leading edge to trailing edge, complete portion is known as rib. Similarly, there will be a longitudinal running member, right, across the spanwise direction. Those are known as spars. So this complete thing, what you are seeing here, this girder kind of structure, right, that at leading edge is known as front spar. Same kind of structure you will find at the back side, that is called rear spar. All right. So spars are basically spanwise running members, or these will be directly connected to the fuselage. So these spars basically connect, will connect wing to the fuselage, right? And apart from that, if you look at this spacing, right, which is spacing is there between ribs, right, particularly can be utilized to store the fuel, because fuel is to be stored inside the wing, right? So there will be a small containers, right, which will be kept within the spacing of the ribs, or there will be a special space used to be provided to attach the fuel tanks. On some of the aircraft, complete wing itself will be a fuel tank in which fuel will be stored. All right, so like that it is to go. So again, if you look at the some more detailed view of the aircraft wing, look at here, this is the rim, right, which is making the airfoil shape. And these are the cutouts, right, through which your spar will be moving, right? Spar, this is spar basically. This is the spar which is moving across the wingspan. And you are seeing this kind of structure, right? This is basically our stringers, right? So stringers will connect the skin basically. So skin will transfer the load to the stringer first, then stringer will transfer the load to the ribs, then it will get transferred through the spar to the fuselage. So like that is a load distribution in the wing. So skin followed by the stringer, rib, then spar. These are the main subcomponents of a wing. So as I said that the wings of an aircraft, basically purpose of wing is to get the normal reaction, which is called the lift. They are designed basically very right as per the type of aircrafts, right, our size or weight and desired speed in the flight and at landing and rate of climb particularly. So these are the various factors which will basically influence over the type of the wing to be chosen for the required required purpose. So often wings are full cantilever, you will find in most of the aircrafts, right, wings will be fully cantilever design. This means they are built so that no external bracing is needed, but in some of the aircraft you will find semi cantilever wing also, and wing will be supported by the internally structures are ribs, spars, stringers and all, right. So what are the spars? Spars are the principal structural members of the wing. They correspond to the longerons of the fuselage. If you try to relate, then the same function will be done by the longerons in the fuselage, but here it is done by the spar. All right, they run parallel to the lateral axis of the aircraft from the fuselage towards the tip of the wing and are usually attached to the fuselage by wing fittings, plane beams or aters. Spar may be made of metal, wood or composite materials depending on the design criteria of specific aircraft. Wooden spars are usually made from the spruce. Spruce is basically the name of one species of wood which used to be found in Africa. It is very light in weight and very suitable for aircraft application. So if we look at, just focus over the spar, they can be classified into four different types, right. The first is this capital A. If you look at this is called solid spar. This is called box shape, right, spar. This is partly hollow, so partly hollow design. And this is the D, that is called I form, I beam, IV form. Mostly from strength of material concept, you may be knowing that I beam construction can withstand larger stresses, right. That's why all the railway tracks, even in older earlier days in the houses also, we were using the girders, right, girders with the stones. So they were basically in the form of I shape. So this is the I beam and this is the double box structure, right, spar. This kind of spars can also be used. So as I said, that may be made of wood, steel, right, or composites, right. So depending on the type of aircraft and the load with which your wing will be subjected to, we select the type of spars to be used. So currently most manufactured aircraft have wing spars made of solid extruded aluminium or aluminium extrusions riveted together to form the spar. The increased use of composites and the combining of materials should make airmen vigilant for wings spars made from a variety of materials. So nowadays, in coming future, will be dominated by the composite materials. So all the components of aircraft will be manufactured by using the composites, right, in coming future. So these are the metal spars examples, right, with maybe in the form of this shape, right, or maybe complete I section, maybe this kind of structure, right, stair kind of structure, or double I beam structure, or maybe this kind of structure. So any one of this form can be used as a spar for the aircraft wing. What are the wing ribs? As I said, ribs will provide the aerodynamic shapes, right, it will provide the airfoil shape. So ribs are the structural cross pieces that combine with the spars and stringers to make up the framework of the wing. They usually extend from wing leading edge to the rear spar, or you can say from leading edge to the trailing edge of the wing. The ribs give the wing its camber shape and transmit the load from skin and stringers to the spar. Similar ribs are also used in the ailerons, elevators, rudders and stabilizers, right. you will find some kind of structures. So wing ribs are usually manufactured from either wood or metal. Aircraft with wood wing spars may have wood or metal ribs, while most of the aircraft with metal spars have metal ribs. The three most common types of wood ribs are the plywood wave, lightened plywood wave, and the truss type. Truss type is having more strength, but only problem with truss type ribs is that their construction is slightly complex, right? That we need to take into account. All right. So we look at the picture of ribs. They will be looking like this, right? So whatever you are seeing, this is our spars and these are all ribs. So ribs, these this is the example of ribs made of truss kind of structure you are seeing here. So this complete truss kind of structure, and this completely forming the rib. All right, and this kind of structure is also there where we are using corrugated sheet before this skin. So what is the purpose of corrugated sheet? Corrugated sheet will distribute your load evenly, right, across the rib length. And this kind of cutout sections, right, instead of, you know, truss kind of structure, there may be a cutout sections in between these parts. So these are all spars, vertical members, and between cutouts you may find, right, these are false spar. Basically is a part of rib, but this red portion that you are seeing, these are the spars. So two spar configuration. So if we look at the skin particularly, so if you open the skin, this is the upper skin basically, right? You have removed that. The moment you are removing that, you will find this kind of structure, right? That is called corrugated inner skin. What is the purpose of corrugated inner skin? To provide sufficient, you know, what we say, the safeguard between, you know, inner surface and an outer skin. And also it will distribute the load evenly across the spars. This is the reflector rod, right? And this thing you are seeing, this is called wingtip navigation light, right? Navigation light. And this thing that you have removed, this access panel for especially this, and this box kind of structure you are seeing, this will be basically utilized for storing the fuel. So this is the access panel that you can remove and you can look for. All right. So in general, wing construction is based on the three fundamental design. First is monospar, where we'll use only one spar for designing the wing. Multispar, where we use more than one spar in the wing construction. And box wing, where spars will be in the form of boxes. Right. So out of these three, majority aircrafts are having multispar configuration. But in the transport aircraft, particularly where we want to store larger luggages, right, larger fuel to carry out the mission, we go for box beam kind of design for the wing. So monospar wing incorporates only one main span-wise or longitudinal member in its construction. Ribs or bulkheads supply the necessary contour or shape to the airfoil. Although this thick monospar wing is not common, this type of design modification by the addition of false spars or light shear waves along the trailing is for support of control surface is sometimes used. So, and if you look at this design, particularly this kind of vertical members are known as false spars. They are not spars, but they will be acting like spars. Multispar, the multispar wing incorporates more than one main longitudinal member in its construction. To give the wing contour, we use the ribs or bulkheads will be used to provide the wing contour in the case of multispar. Box beam, the box beam type of wing construction uses two main longitudinal members with connecting bulkheads to furnish additional strength and give contour to the wing. A corrugated sheet will be used particularly in box beam kind of structure between the bulkhead and smooth outer skin, so that wing can better carry tension and compressive loads. Right. So if you look at the design of the box beam, which will be something like this, it will be forming small boxes, right, that can be utilized for storing the fuel, right, particularly in the wing. All right, and this is the outer skin, and this is the corrugated sheet that we shed, right? This will be used for making your aircraft enable to carry tension and compression loads effectively. So if we summarize the things, right, what we have covered in this particular lecture, the principal structural parts of wings are basically spars, ribs and sponges. These are reinforced by trusses, I-beam, tubing or other devices including the skin. The wing ribs determine the shape basically and thickness of the wing. So the purpose of ribs is only to provide the required airfoil shape and the thickness. In most modern airplanes, the fuel tanks either are an integral part of the wing structure or consist of flexible containers mounted inside the wing. So some of the aircraft complete wing may be considered as fuel tank, and some aircraft you may find the flexible containers which will be placed inside the wing. So with this basically we have covered the basic wing design, right? How actually what are the different components of the wing, that has been covered. So if you are having any doubt in this particular topic, aircraft wing design, their different subcomponents, their functioning, please feel free to write in the comment section, or you can directly send me WhatsApp messages. I will reply for the same. All right. So with this, basically we have covered the general types of construction, fuselage and wing. And fuselage, basically we have covered three types of fuselage design. One is called truss type, that we call Warren truss, and then monocoque, then semi monocoque. And we have clearly seen that semi monocoque structure can withstand larger stresses, right, without any appreciable damage to the structure compared to the monocoque. But monocoque design, basically problem is we have to use the high strength material. So when we are going for high strength materials to be used for monocoque construction, it will invite the weight penalty. And the aircraft design, basically our main purpose is to keep the components light in weight. There basically we have to make the compromise. Particularly we are selecting the monocoque kind of, you know, construction for the aircraft fuselage. The problem with the truss kind of configuration was, even though it was able to withstand the larger stresses, right, and is a fail-safe design, right, that means one component is failed, complete structure will not damage, right, all of a sudden. But problem with truss type of configuration is that the space will be less in the fuselage, particularly if we are using the same truss type of configuration for the passenger aircraft, then there is a problem of providing enough spacing for the seating arrangement and other equipments, other payload requirements. But in monocoque, space is more right, as there is no internal bracing, internal members. But problem is, we have to use high strength material because there is only one skin, right, that is called stress skin, which will be subjected to all sort of air loads which will be encountered when aircraft is flying. To counter that problem, particularly semi monocoque came into the picture, right, where internal structures, right, like longerons were provided, and frames and bulkheads were provided to strengthen the fuselage shape. And also we can use the cheap materials, particularly low strength material can be used, right, in the semi monocoque construction. And a semi monocoque construction basically can withstand any amount of, you know, loads, right, because load distribution is uniform in the case of semi monocoque. So that was really regarding to the fuselage. And today we have covered the wing design, and we have clearly seen that the main components of the aircraft wings are ribs, spars, stringers and skin. So like stringers will do the same function like longerons did or stiffeners did in the fuselage. So wings will be attached to the ribs via stringers. So first load will be transferred to the stringer, then stringer will transfer the load to the ribs, then finally ribs will transfer to the load to the spars. And spars are the members which will connect the wing to the fuselage. So finally load will be shared with the fuselage. So main body is your fuselage will be, which will be sharing all the loads of the wings. So that is the main thing in the wing. And we have seen one by one detailed explanation of each and every component and their purpose. So with this, I am closing this today discussion, right? See you all in the next class with a new topic, that is aerospace materials. Have a nice day. Good day.